This is my second video looking at the UAP videos released by the US Navy. In the first video, I examined the range estimates performed by Chris Lato and Mick West for the gimbal UAP and found that both estimates did not really have a firm basis. In this video, I'm looking at the FLIR video of the Tic Tac UAP encountered by pilots from the USS Nimitz. I imagine people watching this video are already familiar with these videos, but if not, I recommend this YouTube video as a good introduction. I'll leave a link in the description. The most interesting of the Nimitz encounters is the one described by Commander David Fravor, who by his account had a quite long engagement with a Tic Tac shaped UAP. Unfortunately, there's no video or other sensor data for this encounter, so it's hard to make any quantitative analysis to corroborate the account. I think I just have to keep an open mind about that one, unless or until any sensor data is released. There is one encounter, however, where FLIR video was recorded, and we also have the direct testimony of an eyewitness, the person who took the video. So this is the one I'm going to look at. The video was taken on a different sortie, but in the same region, by a Lieutenant Commander Chad Underwood, also from the Nimitz. This might or might not be the same object encountered by Commander Fravor, so I'm going to analyse the account in isolation on its own merits. I would like to say at the start that I don't regard myself as a UFO debunker. You can see from my other videos that I like to analyse both sides of a story using mathematical analysis and try to deduce what might be true and what is probably false. You usually find that neither side is completely right or completely wrong, and there is some grey area. I'll leave you to decide if I do a fair analysis in this video. Here is the video I'm going to analyse. It's a recording of an infrared image of an unidentified object taken from an F-18 using the Raytheon AN-ASQ-228-AT FLIR pod. There are some important parts of the display we need to understand. You can freeze the video and read the description on the right for other parts of the display. This number at the top, in the centre, is the heading of the FLIR pod relative to the F-18 heading. On the left here, we see the zoom setting, and in the centre, the two vertical bars mentioned by Chad Underwood. This horizontal bar represents the wings of the F-18 relative to the horizon, so in this case, pretty much straight and level. The statements from Lieutenant Commander Chad Underwood that I'm going to assess are taken from an interview he did with Jeremy Corbell, published in this YouTube video. The most important claim is that the UAP manoeuvred in a way that outperformed the F-18 and can't be explained by known physics. Here's a summary from James Corbell.
The unidentified craft they observed and engaged that day was able to outpace and outmaneuver our nation's most advanced warplanes. It did, in fact, zoom off to the left of Underwood's wing, and it broke the lock of his AT FLIR targeting pod, which is not an easy thing to do.
James puts it to Chad Underwood that debunkers have claimed there is a possible explanation for what happened that doesn't require extraordinary physics.
Debunkers say, when you're filming, it only appears to move left, but in fact, it was you banking your craft.
Aircraft was straight and level at that point. If you look at the FLIR pod, there's no change in heading or altitude or airspeed. Our aircraft was straight and level the entire time.
Lieutenant Underwood insists that the FLIR would not lose track on an object under those circumstances. He seems very sure.
I was at a very benign heading, airspeed, altitude, and bank angle that the FLIR will not drop that track.
He describes how you can tell when a track is dropped by looking at the vertical bars on the FLIR display.
When the aircraft zips off to the left and you see the two bars that were on either side of the Tic Tac, you'll see they'll try to like reacquire. When you see those two bars kind of widen, that means it's trying to like open up its eyes wider to find you again and then get back to an auto track. By that point, the Tic Tac is already way off the left side of my scope, and basically it's gone.
James also asks Chad about the effect of changing zoom, also referenced by some debunkers, and he states again that this will not cause the track to drop.
They also say that there was a 2x zoom right at that moment when the Tic Tac UFO appears to shoot off to the left, so it's an exaggerated speed. Do you lose track on it? What makes it go left?
When you go from 1 to 2x or something like that, 1 to 2x zoom, you're not dropping the track and trying to reacquire it in 2x zoom. At no point will it drop track.
Chad is confident that the track was dropped due to an extreme maneuver by the Tic Tac.
I go through all the zoom features, and I'm not dropping its track. The track is there the entire time. It broke my lock by zooming off to the left.
The Tic Tac shot off to your left.
Yeah, yeah, with instantaneous acceleration. If it were just to kind of veer off to the left, the FLIR would be able to track that with no problem. But it shot off at an instant acceleration that the FLIR just is not engineered to be able to hack, I guess.
Then finally, Chad highlights that this perceived instantaneous acceleration is one of the main features that drives his opinion of this encounter.
The Tic Tac UFO shot off to the left from a standstill with instantaneous motion. Explain that.
I can't. Can't describe from a physics-based perspective. I can't do it. Things don't just instantaneously accelerate like that. That's the part that I took away from the whole experience, was that moment where it just zipped off. That was my kind of weirded out moment. At this point, I ruled out everything that it could possibly be, and I'm left with, I have no fucking idea what this thing was.
Even though the video looks fairly boring until the last second, I think there's good information in it that will enable us to investigate Chad's description. Let's take a look. First, I'll put a plot on the right here to show a top-down schematic of what's happening. The cross here indicates the F-18 position, and its heading is towards the top of the screen. We can show the relative position of the UAP on the plot. Bear in mind, this is a position relative to the F-18, which is always the origin of the plot, even though the F-18 is moving. The UAP is shown as a black circle, and this red dotted line shows the direction that the FLIR pod is pointing. This is relative to the F-18 heading and is 4 degrees right at the start of the video, shown at the top here. I've exaggerated all the angles on this plot to make it easier to understand, so it's just a schematic. We can show the field of view of the FLIR, again exaggerated, with this blue dotted line. This represents a 1x zoom that is indicated on the display here, and when the zoom changes to 2x, the field of view will be reduced to half, like the cyan line here. Now let's play the video. The UAP is in the centre of the image between the two vertical bars, so the FLIR is locked on the track, which means the UAP is 4 degrees right of the F-18 heading. At some points the zoom is changed, but the track stays in the centre of the two bars, so the lock is not lost. The polarity is also changed, and the track is still not lost. The FLIR heading starts to move further to the left, still with lock, indicating that the UAP's relative position is moving left. A range display appears, but it's just a sequence of nines, which probably indicates the range is not actually determined. This would likely be coming from the radar. At this point, something interesting happens. The FLIR performs a gimbal roll. I won't explain in detail here, but it has a limited range of azimuth, so sometimes needs to roll to carry on tracking. You can see that when it rolls the target out of the center, and the FLIR momentarily loses lock. As described by Chad Underwood, the vertical bars widen, indicating it's trying to reacquire, and it eventually recovers the track. The UAP carries on moving to the left relative to the F-18, and is now on the left side of the aircraft by a few degrees. So it's moving to the left relative to the F-18, like this. The zoom is changed again 2x. If we look at this frame by frame and watch the overlaid characters, you can see that when the zoom changes on the image, the overlay doesn't immediately change. There's a delay of a few frames before the software displays the correct zoom. This is zoomed two times, but one is still displayed. Then the overlay catches up. At this point, something interesting happens. The zoom is changed again, and there's some kind of glitch on the video. If we look frame by frame, we can see that the zoom is changed from 1 to 2, then the UAP track is lost. Perhaps this is it near the bottom of the screen, but it's hard to see. We seem to have lost the track, and then there's a glitch on the video image, a white screen, and then a few frames with no image but just the overlay on a black background. When the image comes back, the track still seems to be between the vertical bars, but they widen and reacquire the track anyway. The UAP is 8 degrees left of the F-18 heading at this point. From the video we've watched so far, we can see that the FLIR tracks the target from just to the right of the F-18 nose to 8 degrees left of the nose, and momentarily loses the track and reacquires twice, once from a gimbal roll and once after a glitch following a zoom change. We can show roughly what's happening on our schematic. Relative to the F-18, the UAP goes from right to left and is tracked by the FLIR, which loses track a couple of times but reacquires. We don't have range, so we don't know exactly how the UAP is moving, but as the F-18 is going straight and level, we know the UAP is going from the right to the left. It's interesting to plot the bearing rate to see how dynamic the situation is. So let's create a new plot to do that. This plot has time on the x-axis and the FLIR pod relative bearing on the y-axis, with right being positive and left negative. As the FLIR has a lock for most of the time, this is effectively the relative bearing to the UAP. I'm going to plot the number exactly as shown on the screen for every frame. This is how it looks, starting at 4 degrees right, stepping a few times between 4 and 3, and then steadily moving left. The FLIR only displays whole numbers with no decimal places, so the plot has steps in it, and we only know the bearing within plus or minus half a degree. If we assume the value is rounded to the nearest integer, then we know at the step from 4 to 3, the actual value is crossing 3.5. We can use this to plot known points at each crossing, 2.5, 1.5, etc. There's one strange point here where the display jumps from 1 degree right to 1 degree left. If we look at this point on the video, we don't see anything happening to the image. So my assumption is that the display of the L is some kind of software bug or error, and it's really still 1 degree right, so this part is not correct. If I replot with that corrected, this is what we get. Now if I plot the known points where the integers change, we can see the UAP bearing rate. The bearing rate is low for the first few seconds, then begins to move to the left with the rate gradually increasing. It's a fairly slow and steady rate change, So there's no dramatic maneuvering apparent in this section. On our schematic, this is just a fairly steady drift from right to left, as we indicated earlier. As Chad Underwood said, the dramatic action is right at the end of the video, so I'm going to examine that frame by frame. I'll use two plots here. The upper plot will show each frame of the video in turn. On this, I'll overplot a red cross at the center, which is where the FLIR is pointing. This is the frame that I'm starting at 1 minute 13.6 seconds. I'm going to mark the position of the UAP on this plot and measure how far from the center it is. On the second plot below, I'm going to plot the distance from the center point in degrees versus time. I can calculate degrees as I know that the FLIR total field of view is 0.7 degrees in 1x zoom and 0.35 degrees in 2x zoom. When the FLIR has a lock and the UAP is at the center, the value will be zero, as it is in this first frame. Now I'm going to step through frame by frame and plot the points on the lower plot. In the third frame, there's a glitch in the video, and we can't clearly see the UAP anymore. I'll mark this point with a question mark. This glitch seems to be associated, or at least simultaneous, with a switch between zoom settings. The next few frames are even more unclear. Then there are a few frames where the video image is lost completely, and we only have the overlay on a black background, similar to what we saw before. I mark all these frames with a question mark. The video picture comes back again, but again with a glitchy image. Perhaps this is the UAP just above the red cross, but I'm not certain. The next few frames are again just the overlay on a black background. Eventually the image comes back and we can clearly see the UAP again. It's just off to the left of the center. We've had a period of around a quarter of a second where I couldn't confidently say where the UAP was in the frame. Now that we have the image back, I'm going to put a box around the UAP, mark its center, and measure how far this is from the red cross. I plot this for each frame on the lower plot. Here it's just slightly off to the left. I continue doing this, and for the next few frames, it's just off to the left. You start to see the vertical bars widen, indicating that the FLIR has lost the lock and is trying to reacquire. In this case, the FLIR does not reacquire, and the UAP starts to drift further off to the left. At this frame, the zoom level is changed to 2. We showed earlier that there's a short delay before the overlay is updated, so this still shows 1 for a few frames. Showing this on the video on the left, we can see that there's no big image change when the overlay changes from 1 to 2. So it's clearly a few frames late, and the real zoom change is a few frames earlier. Also, when we calculate the next position with the field of view for 2x zoom, we see the bearing rate is consistent. Now we can carry on with the frame-by-frame analysis, and we see the UAP is continuing off to the left at a fairly consistent rate. Eventually the UAP moves off the screen and we can't calculate its position for the last few frames of the video. We have just over a second of tracked positions, showing a fairly constant rate. Now let's pull up our earlier plot again. We can plot a rough straight line through the frame-by-frame analysis that we've just done. If we zoom into the end of our previous plot, we see a fairly consistent rate based on the slew of the FLIR as it tracks the target. We don't know what's happening for about a quarter of a second, but I'll just extrapolate a little for that region. Now we know that the FLIR lost track somewhere in that region, and I speculate that when it loses track, it will hold its current bearing. I don't know this for sure, it may continue to slew for a short time. Assuming it holds its position, we can plot our movement from the frame-by-frame analysis onto the end of the earlier plot. We see that the bearing rate is fairly close to what we had before. So the analysis seems consistent with the UAP moving slowly from right to left at a fairly constant rate, with no sudden changes of rate, even in the section at the end where it moves off to the left of screen. If we plot our schematic, we can demonstrate this hypothesis. The UAP moves from right to left, tracked by the FLIR. The FLIR loses track a couple of times, but quickly reacquires. On the third occasion the FLIR loses lock, it doesn't reacquire. It holds its current bearing, and the UAP, continuing at the same rate, moves off the screen. This is how that appears on the video. Let's go back to some of Chad Underwood's statements and make some conclusions. Chad says that the F-18 is straight and level throughout. I agree, we can see this clearly from the video. The F-18 doesn't manoeuvre during the whole engagement. Secondly, Chad says the track is locked the entire time, up until about the last second. I disagree. We can see at least two earlier times when the track is lost and reacquired, one from a gimbal roll and another following some glitch in the video. Thirdly, Chad says that the track will not be dropped during zoom changes. I think this is a little bit less clear and debatable. We can see two times where the track loss seems to be associated with zoom change, but other times where the zoom changes and the track is not lost. And finally, I think the most important claims, that the UAP zooms off to the left, the UAP moves with instantaneous acceleration, and the UAP outperforms the F-18. Well, I have to disagree. The analysis shows an entirely plausible UAP motion that is completely benign and conventional, and closely matches the video observations. The F-18 isn't maneuvering at all, and the UAP doesn't seem to manoeuvre either. So what's the summary? Well, we still don't know what this UAP is, but I think we can say that there is a plausible explanation of what we see in the video that doesn't require instant acceleration or any physics-defying maneuvers. Chad Underwood said that it was the UAP zooming off at the end of the video that amazed him, and we know that he didn't get within visual range, so I think he's basing his opinion on what he saw in this FLIR video. I think if he studied this analysis closely, he might have cause to be a bit less sure of his statements. I think we have to respect the eyewitness testimony, but where we have other sensor evidence, we can try to corroborate it. Even the best trained observer is still a human and can make mistakes or misinterpret what they're seeing. We need to go one step at a time, piece by piece. Some parts will be verified, some will not. In this case, the video analysis doesn't corroborate the testimony that the UAP performed physics-defying maneuvers, or even any maneuvers at all. This doesn't in any way explain what Commander Fravor saw earlier in the day, but we don't have any sensor footage of that engagement, so I think that will have to remain a mystery for now. If you see anything wrong in my analysis or have any other questions, leave a comment below. I think there's still a bit more mileage left in this topic, so I might do another video.